In just one other manifestation of the untold brilliance of a man named Pope John Paul II, he gives the church and the world the theology of the body. Now, in heart, in essence, you can summarize the theology of the body in 5 words. And don't tell don't tell Father Joseph that I'm saying that's enough for his course. Maybe it's prophetic, making reference to him as saint. And that is, the body expresses the person. The body expresses the person. There was a movement in the 60s and early 70s. It was an unfortunate movement. It was a movement of dissenting moral theology. And one of the rationales for committing significant sins of the body was, I'm just doing it in my body. I'm not really doing it in my heart or in my soul. Well, if a person's in that confusion, try jumping off a bridge, but just in your body. And then very quickly, you'll understand what's called hylomorphism, the essential unity between soul and body. So that the body expresses the person even applies to our sweet Jesus, who shows his hands and his feet, saying, if you see my body, you see what I've done for you. An infinite love we cannot fully grasp, but we will spend all eternity trying to grasp it. And that's a positive thing. Now, what about asking for something to eat? It would not be appropriate if we simply thought that redeeming the entire human race burned off calories and therefore he wanted to get some nourishment. Why does he ask to eat fish? Something visible to prove that it is his body. Not a vision. Ghosts can't sustain matter. And so his body is expressing his person, the Jesus who dies, who rises, and who will ascend. That's why we are all redeemed. That's why we are all saved. Well, John talks about how important it is that we keep the law of Jesus. He says, if we don't keep the law of Jesus and say we know him, rather hard words, we're liars. And part of keeping that law is, of course, in the context of the body. Now, we heard a very prominent Peter in the first reading. Is this the same Peter that denies Jesus? He's giving proclamations. One homily gets about 5,000 people. That's not a bad homily to conversion ratio. One homily, 5,000 converts. What happened to him? Well, what happened to him is called Pentecost. And if you're feeling that, well, I don't feel completely renewed. I had a good Lent. Easter was pretty good. But I'm still battling with things. Well, that's because we haven't had Pentecost yet. We haven't had the full gift of the Spirit. And as the early church would get little shots of Jesus, but then they were still not sure what they should do. So that's true for us. That will go on. But one dimension of another prominent statement about the body coming from a pope happened on Monday. Our Holy Father, through the office of the Dicastery for the Doctrine of Faith, came out with a document called Dignitas Infinita, infinite dignity. Some criticized the Holy Father saying, you know, you really shouldn't say that human beings have infinite dignity until they found that Pope Francis was actually quoting St. John Paul II, then they didn't have a problem with it. Okay. So it's from Pope John Paul II. I just want to bring out 3 elements of an instruction by which we help to tell Jesus, we're not liars. We're really trying to live the law. There's not a separation between law and love. And we're seeking the truth and we're trying. And that's what this document did on Monday. So just 3 specifics. Number 1, abortion. The Holy Father, as he has said many times, you don't solve problems by hiring a hitman. Now, that's not the quote that's in this document, but he said that maybe 5 times. You don't solve any problems by killing someone. And so he again quotes St. John Paul II saying, be careful of the ambiguity of language that has now entered the abortion discussion. Things like, it's a termination or an interruption of pregnancy. He essentially says, don't do that because you're going to lessen what's really happening. Procured abortion is the direct killing of an innocent human being. And so every time you hear the jargon, just replace that, whether it be reproductive health or it's really my body, just replace it with killing unborn babies. And that way we can have a proper reverence for the kid and a proper horror for abortion. He then speaks about surrogacy. Now, surrogacy might be something far from your minds and even thoughts. Some might say, well, I don't know what it is. Well, surrogacy is in Italian what you call utero in affitto, which literally and rather grotesquely means a womb for rent. It's where you hire a woman to have your child, a woman that's not your wife. And so the Holy Father says through the congregation, this does harm to both child and mother. It objectifies the woman, and the child doesn't even get to have a human origin. It's artificial. And so in no case can this be justified. Now, once again, you might say, well, who would really consider that? So let me go back to a far-off university somewhere in the Northern Hemisphere and a student some 20 years back who came up after class and said, Dr. Miravalle, my sister and brother-in-law are having a tough time conceiving. And so they asked me if I'd be a surrogate mother. And she said, I'm pro-life. I want to help them out. And so we had to discuss how you can never separate the procreative and unitive dimension of sexuality and marriage. My point is, this was a young, trying to be faithful Catholic girl who just didn't understand the teachings. Sometimes we get, I think, we lose the appreciation for what we just inherit in terms of wisdom on some tough questions. For us, it's no-brainer because we've been formed in this. But here was a woman, young woman, saying, I want to help. And so once again, the importance of the Vatican saying very quickly, under no circumstances do you separate the unitive and procreative ends and purposes of sexuality in marriage, even if it fosters a life. And then thirdly, and perhaps most importantly for our age, is the teaching that comes forward on transgenderism. Now, the Pope, if you listen carefully to Peter, Peter kind of gives them an excuse. He said, look, I know you were acting in ignorance when you killed the Savior and you opted for a murderer instead of the God-man. He said, I know you and your leaders were acting in ignorance. Well, that's a nice pastoral effort to try to say, still, you need to repent and believe. So Pope Francis, through the congregation in this document, says, any discrimination against a human being who has a different sexual orientation can never be justified. There's no room for it because we don't know the background of why they have this orientation. So always make the distinction between the moral act and a disposition of someone who, in some cases, through no fault of their own, can be ill-disposed, ill-directed. And most of all, you can never, ever ponder the idea that they're not having the image of God, that they don't have the infinite dignity the rest of us have. Then what does he say? He says, to try to change your body, to try to change your sex, is giving in to the age-old temptation of playing God. Now, my friends, that's what theologically in old scholastic terms we call a kaboom statement, okay? Playing God. So there's the clarity. Okay, after saying everyone is a person, we have to respect everyone as a person, you simply can't do this. This is the opposite of theology of the body. You can't change the exterior of your body as if it's going to change your interior. That's given by God. And so in no case can transgenderism be supported. In no case can sex changes be supported. And this is the truth of Christ through the Vicar of Christ and through the Dicastery. Well, finally, what about us? What about our struggles with our bodies. The Catechism says that chastity is an apprenticeship in self-mastery. That means it's a progression. It takes place. I overheard two friends saying, one said, why don't we get Divine Mercy Sunday every Sunday? I'm already out of my baptismal purity. The other person said, yeah, I was out of it 3 hours after, you know, the Mass. Okay. And then one person made allusion as if they were in mortal sin. So let's just be very clear about what the Church teaches. My friends, if we go to the right of the Church or we go to the left of the Church, we're following a political idea of the French Revolution. It's not called Catholicism. We follow the Church, what the Church says, in its entirety. So what does the Church say about mortal sin? The Church says you need three elements for mortal sin. Number one, it's got to be grave matter. Number two, there has to be full knowledge. Number three, there has to be full consent. Do not equate grave matter with mortal sin as if that necessarily is always the case. If you're doing so, you would be doing it on your own, but you wouldn't be doing it in union with the Church. So let me read to you just this reference for the Catechism so we're clear. Catechism, CCC 1857, for sin to be mortal, three conditions must together be met. Mortal sin is sin whose object is grave matter and which is also committed with full knowledge and deliberate consent. Mortal sin requires full knowledge and complete consent. 1816 adds, quote, the prompting of feelings and passions can also diminish the voluntary and free character of the offense, as can external pressures or pathological disorders. So in cases like that, again, this is the Catechism, a grave act is not a mortal sin. Can we commit mortal sins? Of course we can. It's a reality. It's a deadly sin. But we want to be careful not to inflate. Okay? If you don't have full knowledge, which most of us would have knowledge, what the Church teaches, but if we don't have full, what the Catechism says, complete consent, then it's not a mortal sin. It's a venial sin. And the Catechism chases that by talking about how receiving communion forgives venial sins. It says, this is 1394, as bodily nourishment restores lost strength, so the Eucharist strengthens our charity, which tends to be weakened in daily life. And this living charity wipes away venial sins. So what's the goal? The goal is to live what the Church teaches. Not laxity, not rigidity, because neither one of those serve Christ. And yes, today is not Divine Mercy Sunday. But guess what? He is Divine Mercy. The Sunday is a remarkable gift that we had last week. But it's Him. It's He. It's He who we're going to receive in 15 minutes. He is Divine Mercy. So as we're called to do with each other, let's do with ourselves. Always err towards mercy, because it's God's greatest attribute. And let's ask Our Lady for that grace, because, you know, as we had our eclipse event earlier, ours was not too dramatic. Those in the Northern Kingdom blew off school entirely. I'm sure it had nothing to do with the eclipse. But obviously, there's certain times we can't look directly into the sun. It'll hurt us. But you can always look into the moon. The gentleness of the light of the moon is always something we can grasp. And that's why Jesus is the light. He's divine. He's also the just judge. But there's never a time you can't go to the mother. Her gentleness is always approaching. It's always proximate. It always brings us to our Eucharistic Lord. So let's ask our Blessed Mother to live our lives with the balance of the Church and to be witnesses and recipients of His divine mercy. As we pray, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. Blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.